I read what you sent me on your dad. Physics professor at North Carolina State University. Interesting. I enjoyed that.
Thanks, Brian. Okay.
He actually taught a class, ended up teaching a class in at every class at one time in that department is what was in there.
Oh, we got 5 seconds.
Went to UC Berkeley.
All right.
We have 29 minutes.
Is everybody ready?
I am ready. Let me introduce us. Tell me one. Good morning from the office, North Georgia's only live online morning show. Your host here, BKP. And we're back Friday, June 5th here at 9:31. We're back with nationally known citizen journalist, Nydia Tisdale. Nydia, I'm glad to have you. I will tell you, when we first met and I asked you to tell me like what you do, are you a journalist? I didn't quite understand citizen journalism. Before we get kicked off, I encourage people every day to be a citizen journalist. We all could be one. Welcome, and how are you today?
Good morning, Brian Pritchard, and thank you very much for having me on your show. I appreciate it a lot, and I have watched your show a few times, and I actually was on your show a few months ago, but it was just the audio. I wasn't here in person, so it's a privilege to be here in your office today. Thanks for inviting me.
I wanted you to come up and sit down with me because the first time you were on the show, Kyle wasn't the producer here, and I was trying to handle things, and I got some people say, well, the audio wasn't strong enough and one thing after another. And thankfully to you out there, our viewers and listeners, the show has grown and we're putting up more segments. Tell me, what is this? You identify yourself as a citizen journalist.
Yes.
Tell us what a citizen journalist is.
Well, I am unembedded. I'm independent. I freelance. I work for myself. I publish my own material. I select the events that I choose to cover, and I post them on YouTube, and I put them on my blog, which is called aboutforsyth.com. I also put them on social media, on Facebook and on Twitter, and that way the content is available for everyone to see. I attend public meetings of public interest, and I post them online so that the public who are not able to attend have the opportunity to watch it at their leisure in their privacy of their home. And actually, some people who have attended events have told me they have watched my videos multiple times even after the events, because it's helpful as a public record to be able to refer to the video.
How did you get started doing this? What became of interest? Because you and I have talked many a times, and politics and things like that, that's not something you just have always done or found interest in. So how did you really get this going, or what was the first thing that you got interested in?
Well, actually, photography and videography has always been a part of my life, and I brought something like show and tell. I brought a camera that belonged to my father, Wesley Doggett, and he was a physics professor at North Carolina State University, and this was his very first video camera, and the very first event he filmed with this video camera was my baptism. And he would also film all family functions and had quite a collection of videos that he shared with all of the family. He also video recorded my high school graduation in 1980. I actually graduated a year early from high school and started college at North Carolina State University myself at the age of 16. And then he passed away last December of 2013, and I in fact filmed his funeral, which is at the same church as where my baptism was. So it's gone full circle. And the very first time I ever traveled out of the country was to visit my grandmother in Bogota, Colombia, South America. And I traveled with my American grandmother from North Carolina, and we spent a month in South America, and that was the first time I'd ever left the country, first passport I ever had. And my parents gave me a camera and a diary, and they told me to write home and to write letters and record everything I did every day and take lots of pictures, which I did. And so that was the birth of my journalism as far as having a travel log, a daily diary of my events and what I did and keeping track. And I actually still have all of that. And I have been a journalist in terms of keeping a diary, keeping a journal for most of my life. And so that was the birth of my cataloging events in my life. I got my first video camera at age 25, and I would film mostly family functions, birthdays, graduations, weddings, funerals. And then later, when I was working here in Atlanta, Georgia, I was working as a property manager for a private land investor. And there was a proposed landfill adjoining his property in Forsyth County. And he asked me to attend all of the county commission meetings regarding that zoning.
Well, let me interrupt you here, just right here. At this time, you're not used to going to county zoning meetings or anything like that. You're not used to that.
I had not been involved in any sort of local politics or, no, I was not used to going to county commission meetings or city council meetings. No, not at all. I started, and it was a learning process for me, but I did attend, and I addressed the board, and I emailed the board, and I sent out flyers to the neighborhood and property owners and homeowners. I actually had signage on two different roadways to alert people of the meetings. I started posting online, although I didn't have a blog at that time, so I used a lot of emails. And I would scour the internet to try to find emails of people in the neighborhood who would be concerned about this landfill, which would diminish homeowners' values.
Most people that would go sit through a planning or zoning meeting would think, this is the most boring thing I've ever been to in my life. What did you find in those meetings?
Actually, you say it's boring. If it doesn't involve you or your life or your neighborhood, yes, it would be very boring. However, when you have 100 people in a room, all wearing red, who are very passionate about opposing this landfill, you have a common ground, you have a common goal. And so it binds people together who you may have possibly never met previously, who live in your neighborhood, but you've got this common goal to defeat this landfill. And we fought it for 2 years, and at the end of the day, the applicant withdrew his application. And through my research, I actually published a 150-page booklet, which included all of my attachments and my letters, which is available online, with all of the research I had for 2 years in opposition to this landfill, only to discover that the corporate entity that was applying for the landfill was bogus. It was not registered with the Secretary of State. It wasn't a bona fide corporate entity. And there was no footprint for a landfill. It wasn't compliant with Georgia state law, with the EPA requirements of the setbacks. And so there was really no footprint left. And when they discovered that, it was too late. And they had already had their earnest money deposit at risk. And so they continued until we discovered on our own and confirmed with the applicant that, in fact, there was no footprint. And if they had proceeded and lost the zoning, they would get a refund of the earnest money deposit. But if they had succeeded, then they could do a bait and switch and apply for a transfer station, which is misrepresentation to the board and to the public and to the homeowners and to the landowners. And that was the birth of my activism, because we had been misled for years by the applicant, who took the advice of the zoning attorneys, who took the advice of the planning director, who took the advice of the engineers, all of those people who have the qualifications and the fancy titles after their names and the abbreviations, who should have guided this applicant on what you can do with your land and what you cannot do with your land. And everyone was happy to take his money as long as he was paying their legal fee and their engineering fee, and even the planning director was getting paid for processing his application. And after a couple of years, it was too late. He was in too far and he couldn't withdraw. He spent over $100,000 on this application for naught. It was bogus. So he finally withdrew the application. and got a partial refund of his earnest money deposit. But no one should have to go through that. And that is why I fight and I proofread and I fact check, because just because it's in writing doesn't mean it's correct or it's accurate or it's legal. You have to double check the law, make sure it's compliant with state law, with federal law, with local law, because if it isn't, it's not a valid use. And so I read these applications, I review them closely. I was a proofreader for my school newspaper, the technician at North Carolina University. So I do double check and triple check, and I find mistakes over and over and over again. And that's not just an isolated incident. I found other applications where the corporate entity didn't exist. If you can't even get your name right, if you can't even create a company, which isn't hard to do, how can you expect to manage a landfill, which is highly dangerous?
When I say boring, and let me just state this, and I understand what you're saying, but when I say boring, because I'm talking just to telling people that they should get involved and go to a planning and zoning meeting, and they should get involved and go to a tax assessor meeting, and they should get involved and sit through these, they'll think, well, these are boring. Because I like what you said there, because they no disrespect, absolutely none to education, but you go to these meetings, higher education, and because somebody stands up and they're dressed a certain way, and they have a title behind their name, and they speak in these acronyms, and you're sitting out in the audience, and they are laced with so many acronyms, and you're thinking, oh, well, maybe I shouldn't question that, because, you know, who am I? And so now all the things you're talking about, you did not go to that meeting that day when you were told, hey, go to these planning and zoning meetings and keep an eye on it for me, or keep your ear open. You didn't think that day, hey, I'm going to start really digging into this, did you?
Well, the process lasted for so many years. And there was a landowner next door who had three houses that she had as an investment. A little old lady who would walk to these meetings on carrying a cane, would hobble in there, and she was worried to death. She was worried sick about this landfill that would completely destroy her property value. And that was her legacy. That was what she was going to leave her children. And she lost sleep over that. She didn't deserve that stress or that worry. No one did. They continued the farce. They continued the charade. And that's what gets my goat, until we actually convince the applicant, negotiate a settlement with the landowner. It's subject to zoning the contract to purchase the property. Maybe you can get some of your money back. And that's in fact what they did. Half a loaf of bread is better than no loaf at all. And they withdrew. And the applicant actually had his house advertised for foreclosure and declared bankruptcy. He was the biggest loser in all of this, because he took the advice of all of these professionals. And one of these professionals is, in fact, well, I don't know if I should say this. I'll refrain.
Well, that's up to you. I don't stop anybody. We have this crazy, we just, no bad words, we call it. And outside of that, freedom of speech is freedom of speech. Okay, so now, this is your first, you have a background, I don't want to just say like, you have a background in enjoying video and photography, so you have an enjoyment of that. But this is this where you start thinking, or is this where you say, hey, I'm going to take my video camera and I'm going to go to the city meeting, and I'm going to get a little deeper, I think I should look at some more stuff. So how did you get started doing that? Because there are some other things that you did. And did you know your rights? Now, when you went to your first meeting with a camera, because I talk about this, did you know your rights when you walked in? Did you know you had the right as a citizen to take your camera? Talk about doing that.
Good question, Brian. Thank you. When I attended a lot of these meetings, I would speak during public comment. I would speak during public hearings. I would address the entire board. I would send emails to everyone in the county that I could find emails for. All the department heads, the county manager, the commissioners, the county attorney, because I was very concerned about all of this. And one particular commissioner, during a public comment, period where that's 3 minutes that the public is allowed to address the board. He peppered me with questions and badgered me while I was speaking and wouldn't let me give my speech. And he was harassing me verbally. And finally, another commissioner on the board said, "Excuse me, Chairman, this is called public comment and we're hearing from everybody but the public." And the chairman said, "Yes, you're right, continue, you'll have the full length of your time." And so after that, several people suggested that this was a violation of your First Amendment rights. So I actually sought legal counsel to find out was it or not, and they didn't think it was necessarily warranted any action. However, they did give me the Red Book, and this is a citizen's guide to open government, Georgia Sunshine Laws, which includes the Open Meetings Act and the Open Records Act. And the Red Book changed my life. It's put out by the Attorney General's Office, the First Amendment Foundation, and the Georgia Press Association. This is the book that told me I can video record meetings. Prior to that, I had started audio recording after these multiple verbal attacks from this particular public official during public meetings in public places. To protect myself, I started carrying an audio recorder, and that evolved into a camera, and that evolved into a video camera. I would take photographs of the officials during the meetings. He would pull out his cell phone and take a photograph of me sitting in the audience during a public meeting. So it was kind of interesting, and he actually did not win his bid for re-election. But the Red Book is a wonderful guide. It's again put out by the Attorney General's Office, and it's free for the asking. It's also available online. You can find the content. And I'm very grateful that Attorney General Sam Olens has in fact published this book. His campaign platform was a rewrite of Georgia Sunshine Laws and updating it for today's technology and talking about electronic records, not just physical paper records. And they also reduced the price of a record from 25 cents per page to 10 cents per page. And they addressed a few other items about records and meetings. And so they had rewritten this law and they approved it. The Georgia General Assembly passed it, and it was before the governor for his signature, and Governor Nathan Deal signed the new law on April 17th, 2012. And it was very unique in that the law took effect upon his signature, which is very rare for most laws. Usually it's a few months later or in July 1st that the laws come online, come into effect. And so it was effective that very day, shortly after lunch. And that evening I attended my very first Cumming City Council meeting with my camera to film the proceeding. First time I'd ever set foot in Cumming City Hall. And Mayor H. Ford Gravett, who has been in office now about 45 years, he ordered the chief of police, Casey Tatum, to remove me and my camera, or rather to remove the camera from the auditorium. He said that we don't allow filming inside of City Hall.
All you did was set it up and turn it on. You weren't doing it. Just set it up, turn it on, sit next to it, and boom, that's it. And he made you remove it.
I protested. And I said, "Excuse me, Mayor, Georgia Sunshine Law allows me to film this meeting." He said, "It's not up for discussion. Remove the camera." And so the chief of police and the deputy chief of police grabbed both of my arms and forcibly removed me and my camera out of council chambers. And the third officer picked up my camera bag and handed it to me. And I announced that this is illegal. You cannot close the meeting. I have a right by Georgia law to film this meeting. I will file a complaint with Attorney General Sam Olens, which I did within hours that very night. And on Thursday, 2 days later, the city of Cumming had a letter in the mail from the Attorney General's office addressing that meeting and asking what happened and why did they eject me. And it turned out that actually the city of Cumming films their own meetings from a balcony. And they were video recording this entire meeting. So his statement that we don't allow filming inside of City Hall was false. And PolitiFact wrote an article and they said it was, his statements were false as well. So.
What was the result in that? I mean, I got a lot more, and I know our time is running out, but what was the result in that?
Well, the Attorney General has a mediation program between citizens and their government. If you have a problem, contact them and they'll try to mediate. Well, the mediation failed, and so the Attorney General filed a lawsuit against the mayor and against the city of Cumming. 1 week later, I likewise filed a lawsuit myself in federal court, alleging violations of my U.S. constitutional rights. And that suit was settled on the eve of trial, 3 years after the event, for an amount of $200,000, which most of it went to attorney's fees. And so it wasn't a huge windfall, but I made my point and they conceded.
The windfall was your constitutional rights, correct?
Standing up for my rights, right. In standing up for everyone's rights, all citizens' rights. It wasn't just me, it was everyone. Because if that could happen to me, it could happen to anyone. I had to sue. I had no choice because they wouldn't admit guilt. They wouldn't voluntarily pay the fine, which was $12,000. And the Attorney General won their case in the lower court, and the City of Cumming has appealed it. So the fine is $12,000 plus attorney's fees, which is north of six figures at this point.
So now fast forwarding, you video a lot of political events, you video a lot of political rallies. You just videoed the Georgia State Republican Convention, did you not?
I did, yes, in Athens, and that was my very first state convention, and I found it quite fascinating. It was a learning process. And so when I go to candidate debates or meet and greets and my first convention, I feel that I want to share what I'm learning with other voters so that they can learn the process. So it's a little less intimidating when you go to a city council meeting because maybe you've watched it on my YouTube channel, and I call my videos videos. Or going to court, I've filmed proceedings in magistrate court, in the Superior Court of Georgia, and in Supreme Court of Georgia. So I've filmed several different court proceedings as well. And I may get a few hundred views. My most watched video got over 6,000 views. And my second most watched video got about 10,000 views.
Which ones were those, if I guess?
The one who got the most was an event, a campaign rally at Burt's Pumpkin Farm in Dawson County near Dawsonville. And that made national news as well because I was asked to stop filming or to leave, and I questioned that, and I was ejected, physically removed, and arrested. And that was last August.
That made national news.
It did make national news.
I know nothing about that one. Anyhow.
Actually, Brian Pritchard broke the story. He was there. He was witness to the event. He stood, he sat right behind me and took photographs and audio recorded the entire event. And so he was able to record the speeches that I missed because I wasn't present. And really, I just want to record the political speech so voters can get an education on the candidates who are running and know what their choices are. I don't endorse particular candidates. I don't think people are really all that interested, in my opinion, if I had one. I'm going to learn, to gather information, to gather data, because I'm open-minded. I just wanted to hear what they have to say. And then also the candidates, they ask voters who come to the rallies to spread the message. Tell everybody that there's an election. Tell your friends, tell your family, tell your business associates. And they want you to get the word out and remind people to vote. And so what better way to do that than in the candidate's own words? The video cannot misquote the speaker. And so that's my brand of citizen journalism, is that I film the entire meeting. It could be 2 hours or 5 hours, and you get every word of it. Now, I may also excerpt portions of it and have a shorter video with highlights, but I'll also link to the full length event as well, so you've got all of the content.
Well, I believe in getting the most information for the voters, period, and the most information. I will say, the first couple times I met you and I didn't know you and I'd see you come in with your camera, I thought one of the candidates, or I thought somebody had employed you, because they will do things like that to film their event, because you don't go and it's not like you're obstructing them in any way. And we don't have time for that, but for example, the Pumpkins Farm Day, I was sitting right there and you said, turn your camera on. It's not like you heckling the guy in the front row or anything like that. So I understand. Now, before I want to give you a chance to tell us anything else you have with you today, but I also want to say now, citizen journalism, and I'm when I say pushing, I'm really trying to do segments to get people more involved in their local government because they tend to gravitate to the big state things, and that's good, and they gravitate to hearing about Muslims and ISIS and national things, and that's good to keep track of that, but I think if they would get more into their Board of Education, more into their county commissioner and their cities, some of this stuff would start opening up that it would have bigger effects statewide and nationally. So you have the right to bring a camera in and set it up. And you have a right to video it. And what all meetings do you video in Forsyth? Which ones do you go to attend?
Well, actually, after the mayor kicked my camera out, I started going to as many city council meetings as I could.
I think I'm saying that.
For the last 3 years. And although I was really only interested in one topic, I probably would have gone to one or two meetings and that would have been the end of it. But I kept a close watchful eye on that. And in the deposition of the mayor and his lady friend, they both said under oath on my camera, and that was poetic justice to be able to film both of their depositions in my lawsuit, that the girlfriend is receiving health insurance compliments of the city of Cumming. And that has gotten some scrutiny by the Federal Bureau of Investigation. It's under FBI.
How did you find
that? Well, it was published and it was reported, and they subpoenaed records about that from the city of Cumming, and that's public record, the subpoenas.
Right.
So that was the first of this year.
Now, do you ever do open records requests? Have you ever done open records requests?
Yes, I've done many open records requests, and I've spent thousands of dollars in Open Records Act requests, and they're very useful. And by reading an official's emails, you can find out what they're doing, what they're up to, and you can get certain keyword searches and just get a lot of information. It's very helpful, actually, to have access to the records. And there's no shame in asking for a public record.
People say, and I'm sorry to interrupt you, but people like, they act like it's this big, scary thing. Oh, you want me to go do an open records request? It's your information. When you walk in, and that's the thing that upsets me personally, is when you walk in anywhere, and we got a lot of good people out there. I don't want to be negative. There's a lot of good people in the Board of Education. A lot of good people in some of these county offices. There are. But it's like when you walk in, you have this intimidation, like you're asking them for something. When you walk in, don't be arrogant or rude, but walk in with the attitude, I'm here for my information. I mean, you understand?
There's a reason it's called public records, because
right.
It belongs to the public. We own the records. There's no shame in asking for copies of these records or asking to review them and then decide whether or not you want a copy.
That's why this says they not only can you get a copy, and I don't mean to be rude, but it says in there that they are available for public view. It says that in there. And it's because it's almost like you walk in and say, hey, you know those records you've been keeping for me? I want to take a look at them real quick. That's how simple it's supposed to be.
Absolutely. And they are open, available for inspection, where you can review them for free. There's no charge just to look at records.
Right. You can look at it.
And actually, the planning director I mentioned earlier, there was an Open Records Act request for all of his emails. Well, he only had 6 months of emails. Everything prior to that, 15 years of emails disappeared. He deleted them. Now, destruction of the public record is illegal. He, at the end of the day, lost his job, but the content of those emails were triple X-rated. I mean, they were just really filthy and disgusting emails on his public computer while he was working at the job. And so,
Nydia, we're out of time this morning. I enjoy it. You and I can spend all afternoon talking. Do me a favor. What have you brought with you this morning that we want to
Out real briefly an editorial that appeared in the Atlanta Journal-Constitution a month ago written by Sean McIntosh, who is the deputy managing editor of the AJC, and the title is Motivated Citizen Fights for All. Fights for All Our Rights. And also, I wanted to give you a gift, a little something, which is a CD by my long-haired, handsome husband, who is a professional jazz musician.
I look forward to that.
He recorded this a couple years ago, and I got a photo credit for taking his picture on the back cover in the jacket.
Oh, that's great.
So
that's
enjoy.
Nydia Tisdale, citizen journalist, nationally known, and I enjoy it. We thank you for being here, citizen journalist. Journalism. We're going to take a break. We are going to come back and do our wrap-up. I know we're out of time, but we are going to do our show wrap-up. So, Nydia, thank you very much. Let's go to break, Kyle.